Good morning. If everyone could move to your seats, we'll be starting soon. So we have a little some special activities this week coming up because of a marriage coming up. So we have a baptism coming up this Friday at 4 for Bree, and if you just meet at the McKinnon's house at 4. And then the wedding is on Saturday, right? Okay. And then, of course, we have our usual activities of the Tuesday book reading and the Wednesday Wednesday night at 6:30 at the church, the prayer meeting. And I'll be reading from 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. Dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. This is how you can recognize the Spirit of God. Every spirit that acknowledges that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God, but every spirit that does not acknowledge Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard is coming, and even now is already in the world. You, dear children, are from God and have overcome them, because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. They are from the world and therefore speak from the viewpoint of the world, and the world listens to them. We are from God, and whoever knows God listens to us. But whoever is not from God does not listen to us. This is how we recognize the spirit of truth and the spirit of falsehood. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the truth of your word that you've given us, and we just pray that today, as that is proclaimed, that it would be proclaimed clearly. We just pray that you would help us in the midst of a world where there's a lot of falsehood around, that we would recognize what is false and reject it and hold to what is true. We thank you for your son Jesus and for his life and death for us and his resurrection. And we just thank you for this upcoming baptism and wedding that we can look forward to. And we know that in these things we also see pictures, baptism, a picture of our being united to Christ, and the wedding being a picture of Christ in the church. And we just thank you for these pictures you've given us. And to pray all these things in Jesus' name, amen.
There are lots of benefits and advantages, celebration points or victory points in the life of a body. And some of those come in the form of testimony. There are certain things that encourage believers, but none like a testimony of God's good grace in the gospel. So Friday, Bree is going to be baptized and make a public declaration of what God has done in her heart. But some of you can't be there for whatever reason, and so it is right that you have opportunity to hear her and her testimony. We pray that it's an encouragement to you, as it has been for us in our own family. But she wanted to share that so that you would know who she is in Christ, and the testimony would encourage everybody in here. So with that, this is better now than at the end. We'll get it over with so she can relax and lead us in a time of worship.
All right. Thank you. Okay, so my My testimony ends the same as any other who God saves, from death to reconciliation to himself. Before Christ saved me, my view of God and life was worldly and lost. I followed New Age spirituality and seeked many humanistic truths and desires. I thought of God as a concept or like the universe, but never as the living holy God he is, until he opened my eyes to the truth. Revealed in the person and work of Jesus. During college, I had some friends invite me to their church and share the gospel with me, but I didn't understand, I didn't believe. Looking back, I'm thankful seeds were planted and they still showed me Christ's love. After I graduated, I bought a book about God's characteristics and remember thinking, like, how can I know more about him? God continued to work in my heart and drew me closer to him over time. And revealed his glory and sovereignty through the thing I used to worship, his creation. A memory I have was when I was in Colorado camping, just outside looking at the water, the trees, the sky, the animals, and being in awe of it, Psalm 24. But instead of worshiping creation, I was worshiping the Creator for the first time. God revealed himself as being the one true and living God through this experience. He sought me where I was and changed my heart and mind to follow him. Through hearing other testimonies and reading his word, Christ gave me strength to see my sin, have conviction, and repent. He called me, and I saw how broken and lost I was without him. I remember reading Deuteronomy 18 on New Age practices and other sin being an abomination to God, and for the first time, I had fear of the Lord. I no longer knew him conceptually, but relationally as a holy and heavenly Father. I could never choose salvation in my own strength, only by his grace and sovereignty. It is a free gift I don't deserve and didn't know I even needed for most of my life, but I couldn't imagine life without him, a stranger to him. I'm so grateful he saved me and loved me, leading me to a godly church, preaching his word soundly. Now, as a believer who understands the gospel, I see how the Lord continually protected me throughout my life. He orchestrated my salvation as he orchestrated my upcoming marriage. God's sovereignty and timing are incredible. He put two people together that came from different worlds, all for his purposes. So it's all for his glory. Okay, that's it.
Save it to the end. Is there a t-shirt there?
Okay, so now we have to do worship. Let's see how this first song goes. We're going to try and gather ourselves here. If you guys would go ahead and stand. We're going to try and do this seamless, but do the best we can. It's been a true blessing to hear her testimony. I remember the first time I heard it, I couldn't, you know, I think I cried for an entire day. just how touching it was. How God saved her. drew her to him, and yeah, it's a beautiful story. we're going to try to get to this first song. We're going to sing I'll Wait For You. It's a Getty song. Honestly, it really goes really good with Ruth. Just the truth of the lyrics and just waiting on the Lord, how incredible that is. I mean, his timing is perfect, and ours is not, that's for sure. We have How Deep the Father's Love For Us.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure. He should give his only son to make the wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away as wounds age which mar the chosen one, bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there, until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, have paid my ransom.
Okay, now we have the privilege of actually singing a song that I wrote kind of when we first met. And it's really packed full with a lot of things that I was going through at the time, and a lot of different passages this comes from, and you can really, I mean, find it all throughout Scripture. But it's just been a blessing to really write songs and sing with the person you're going to marry and things like that. It's pretty awesome. So we'll sing this song for you guys. You guys can be seated too. Oh goodness, that didn't sound good. Sorry, guys. Thank you.
God. In the midst of this crooked world, you are worthy of everything I can give. The life I live, it's all yours, God. I was dead in my flesh, desperate for your breath. God, you did a work in me that I could never do. The only hope I have is in you. Desperate for your breath. God, you did a work in me that I could never do. The only hope I have is in you. God, you did a work in me that I could never do. The only hope I have is in you and only. You are worthy. You are worthy. You are worthy.
Please pray with me. Lord, we're so thankful for your word. We're just so thankful that we get to gather as a church, that we get to just love each other. You give us the gift to just be in you, Lord. And you are worthy of our praise. And we're just so thankful for your gift of salvation, Lord. Just love you and praise you in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you, guys. If you take your scripture this morning and go to Ruth chapter 3. The passage this morning is in Ruth 3, and we're going to attempt to look at all 18 verses. I tried to break this into subpoints and try to break the plot in the middle to maybe do something a little shorter, but lucky for you, I couldn't. So we're going to get the whole 18 verses. Ruth chapter 3, beginning in verse 1, is where you will find the text, and I'm going to give you the points as I did last week, because I'm not going to read all 18 verses up front. We'll take them in the portion that we see in the scene as the scene changes. The first thing you're going to see is the first five verses of Ruth chapter 3, and really it's the preparation. And so you're going to see a preparatory statement from Naomi to Ruth. There's only three characters in chapter 3, really. It's Naomi and Ruth, and that's how the scene is going to open. The scene changes, and it's really Ruth and Boaz, and then we're back to the end with Ruth and Naomi. So the preparation is the first thing you're going to see in the first five verses. Beginning in verse 6 through verse 13, you're going to see the attention is on the presentation and what that looks like. And I'm not going to go into that because we're going to look at it in some depth in just a moment. And then lastly, as we pick up in verse 14 through the remainder of the chapter, verse 18, you're going to see the proclamation. We just left in Ruth chapter 2, and it was heavy on the word favor or grace. Transliterating in the original text, especially the New Testament, it's charis, which is the unmerited favor of God. We saw a little different slant on it in Ruth chapter 2. It was to be found with favor. If you remember, the opening scene in chapter 2 is really Naomi offers a prayer on behalf of Ruth. And really, Ruth is given a charge after she made a presentation of request. She asked of her mother-in-law, would it be okay if I go in the field and I glean for the family? And in that place, she only wanted somebody to find favor with her. And that's how she framed it with Naomi. If you will let me go into the field and glean, I will no doubt have provision for the family and I'll bring it back. But in that process, I pray that somebody would find favor with me. Well, we know the story, or the chapter ends with, not only did she find favor, she was really introduced to a kinsman redeemer in the person of Boaz. And I told you, it's kind of interesting the way the story plays out. Naomi is fully aware of Boaz throughout this entire story. It's not like, oh, I didn't know that Boaz was next of kin. As a matter of fact, he was a great man of prosperity. It says great wealth. And we know that last week we break that into two different character understandings or two different profiles of Boaz. The greatness was his character. The prosperity was of God, but he was a wealthy man. He was a man of high character that was a wealthy man to boot. Well, it wasn't that Naomi had to be introduced to Boaz. I don't know, and some of you may be asking, well, why didn't we just jump to the end of the story? Why didn't we just ask Boaz to be the kinsman redeemer and marry Ruth? Guys, I don't know why we don't do that, and I don't know if it was just the bitterness of Naomi. She couldn't look past her own circumstances. I have no idea. But I do know this, we have a tremendous meeting in chapter 3. We're going to have the dialogue begin to really bounce back and forth and ping pong back and forth between the Levirate tradition, the word lever is a Latin word just meaning brother-in-law, and how that's going to really fold into a kinsman redeemer model, a model of what should the family, according to the Levirate tradition or the Levitical law, what was a custom in that day when one would lose his life in the form of a husband, i.e., Ruth's husband, and leave her destitute or with nothing and no bloodline to pass on his name. Was there a provision in Scripture? And we've already set the tone because of Leviticus chapter 25. There is a process by which God would give them encouragement, protection, would give them provision, and would give them the sustaining of a bloodline, a name to be passed on. Well, we've got to get past the point of this is a fact, or this is a tradition, or this is a custom, to the fact that it's actually going to happen in Ruth's life. Something's fixing to happen to make this a reality. And chapter 3 begins to fold in that chance meeting or God's sovereign work. I think it's beyond just happenstance and chance. God is heavy at work in the life of Ruth. Well, I want to pick up, and again, thank you for being gracious to really journey in this book. I know that it's going to take us a little bit of time this morning to kind of unpack, but hopefully we will see the dynamic as being absolutely for our sanctification. Again, a reminder of how good God is in his sanctifying work. Well, this is heavy, as last week was heavy in favor, grace. This is heavy in another word that you see over and over in the book of Ruth, and that is rest and redemption. This is where it was first in chapter 1, really verse 9, where we first see Naomi praying for Ruth, and we see that she uses a word that Ruth would find rest. We know that word is is really defined as security, a provision of trust or a provision of security. And then redemption is just the purchasing back. And you're going to see these two words over and over and over as we go through. We'll pick up the dialogue with me and beginning in verse 1 and chapter 3, and we're going to dive into this. Then Naomi, her mother-in-law, said to her, "My daughter, shall I not seek security for you that it may be well with you?" Now, I want you to go back to, again, I made reference to this just a few minutes ago, but I want you to go back to chapter 1 and verse 9, and I want you to see that she's asking for answered prayer. And she sees that she can put a really play a role in putting together a plan that would be under the provision of God's good grace. Listen to how Naomi prays for Ruth in verse 9, and it says, "May the Lord grant that you may find rest, each in the house of her husband." Praying for both Ruth and Orpah. Orpah is going to wind up leaving later in that chapter, but this is the culmination of answered prayer. So Ruth is really dialoguing with Naomi, and Naomi, in the middle of the conversation, says, "Listen, don't you think that we need to come up with a plan? And I know the pathway by which security can be brought. Rest can be brought to your home. You can see the fulfillment of what I prayed for just a few months ago. You can see God at work because there's a provision under Levitical law that you can have rest in a husband. And I know the pathway. And so shouldn't I set in motion this plan by which you can find rest, that you might have security?" Now, she asked her to do a few things, and it's really interesting. And I'm not sure that this is the pathway to every man's heart, but I think smelling good and putting on nice clothes and looking presentable is probably at least a part of the pathway by which men are attracted to women. Ruth is going to have this dialogue of command as Naomi says, "Okay, I want to put this plan into motion." And you can't just show up and say, "Hey, Boaz, will you marry me?" Because it's the Levirate tradition or it's the kinsman redeemer way. We're going to have to find some way to entice Boaz. Something is going to have to happen that you are really instructed not just to claim your right as a kinsman redeemer, but I want him to find favor with you. Remember that word again? I want the prayer request at the beginning of chapter 2 to be Boaz finding favor for you. Well, he kind of already has, hasn't he? Like, you stay with my maidservants. You fix your attention on the fields that they're in. Don't you dare go to another field. She wanders off into the field with the maidservants, and he tells the gleaners, he tells the men of the harvest, "Hey, drop some of the sheaves. When you're bundling your bundle of harvested barley, I want you to lay a few of those in the turn row. Oh, and by the way, don't embarrass her if she picks them up and claims them for herself. You are not to cause her to blush in any way." And then he makes it very clear as a declaration, "Ruth, you're to do this and you're to follow my gleaners, but I'm telling all the men that are in the field, you don't touch her. You leave your hands off of her." Oh my. So already we see this protective man with tremendous initiative, with generosity on his heart. He must already be looking at Ruth and go, "Wow, okay, I wonder if maybe we could work something out, because I too know the traditions, and I know his I know her father-in-law, Elimelech. I know what he has. I know what he doesn't have. I know why he left. I know why the rest of us stayed here." Guys, he's not ignorant to this either. He knows the story. He knows how this process works too. But we're going to see that it's in the timing of God that all of this begins to unfold. Well, Naomi begins to charge Ruth with a plan. "Don't you think it would be a good idea if I brought a little security to this?" And Ruth is probably sitting at the dining table going, "That'd be a great idea. How are we going to pull this off?" And Naomi lays out the plan. Look at verse 2. "And now, is not Boaz our kinsman? Isn't he a type of redeemer? Isn't he close enough in as a relative to be that one who could bring security
Ruth to a household as a husband. Now, I found this really interesting because as I just read through Deuteronomy and Leviticus, primarily chapter 25, there's really four different ways that kinsman redeemer played out in the Old Testament according to God's rule and his law. The first is if a brother was indebted to another. And that debt became so overwhelming that there's no way I could pay it back. You could have a next of kin or a relative buy back your debt to the one that was owed, and then you became really their servant. You became their hired hand until all things became balanced. So there was a debt that could be paid off through the lens of kinsman redeemer, a family member coming along and paying your debt, so that you'd have to be enslaved or go to prison because you couldn't pay the debt back. There was another, let's just say that a family member was murdered. Kinsman redeemer, the next of kin, could be the blood avenger for that murder. That living offspring or that kinsman could seek out the one who murdered your loved one, and you would take their life and you would avenge for the one that was murdered, kinsman redeemer. Guys, does this look anything like one in the New Testament called Jesus Christ? But there were two that meets this story in the book of Ruth. You could purchase family property back that was lost for whatever reason. Guys, we know, I'm not going to jump the gun into chapter 4, but Elimelech had property. He was also a farmer. And we're going to see that one of the provisions in God's word is, as a kinsman redeemer, a next of kin could go buy the death property of one who passed on. And really that field then would be the provision for the family that suffered loss. But guys, there's another beautiful, and it is the kinsman redeemer, as a brother-in-law or the next of kin, could marry the wife that is widowed and carry on the name so that the name of the deceased would have a lineage from generation to generation. It just so happens, as we get to the end of chapter 4, this is the bloodline of Christ's throne through the person, King David. Well, so we're going to have a plan. He says, I want you to direct your attention, and so the scene's going to look like this. And Ruth, I want you to now begin to think about the kinsman redeemer that you met in the field just a few months ago, Boaz. And the scripture says, here's what I want you to do. He says, and now it is not Boaz our kinsman with whose maid you were? Behold, he winnows barley at the threshing floor tonight. Now, this is like, we don't have like a week. We're getting an opportunity to have several weeks or even several months to prepare for what's going to happen on Saturday. We're talking, fixing to go to the threshing floor, and she's going to work as a maid or a servant at the threshing floor. The barley harvest is complete. The wheat harvest is complete. A couple of months have passed between the end of chapter 2 and the beginning of chapter 3, and now it's time to put the barley up. It's time to put it into the storehouse. And at that conversation, at that breakfast that morning, it's Naomi who looks at Ruth and says, don't you think that I should bring some rest or some security to your life in the form of a husband? Yeah. Well, you know that guy that you've been going to his field every day for the last few months? Yeah. His name is Boaz. He's a kinsman redeemer. How about we just focus on him for a minute? And she's like, that wouldn't be a bad idea. As a matter of fact, I kind of have favor with that too. She says, I just want you to know that he's going to be at the threshing floor tonight. Now, I want you to put this in your mind because this is how it happened. So outside of the city of Bethlehem and any other city that had wheat as a harvest or barley as a harvest, there was a community like a co-op where men would bring their sheaves and their crop to a threshing floor. Now, there's several things that operate at that threshing floor. First, you have to bust up the sheaves. And so they would take them out of their string out, and they would lay them onto a flat surface that they had hammered out, that they had stamped out, and had lightly watered and then gone over again, and it was free of rocks and debris, and it was just hammered out. All the rocks they picked up, they would make a periphery around, and so there was a small rock wall around this threshing floor, this hammered out piece of ground. It was clean, it was slick, it was level. And it was always on a mountain pinnacle, on the edge of a pinnacle that was raised up, so the winds, prevailing winds in the evening, would blow across this threshing floor. Men would bring it, just very similar to what you see in the cotton gins and the co-ops around here. You would designate your sheaves, and it would be marked out for you when it was time for Boaz to winnow or to thresh out his wheat or his barley. He would have his servants bring theirs out onto the threshing floor, and the first step would be oxen or camel or donkey or humans would be dragging these large granite stones or sea stones, and they would just march in a circle one after another, time after time, and they would crush all of the sludge. They would take all the debris off of those pieces, off of those heads of grain. They would rake all that up and they would separate it, but we still have the grain, the precious meat, the thing that's most important is still in the hull. Well, it's crushed, it's ready to be separated, and they would wait till the evening when the winds would die down and the prevailing winds would always be at their back, and it would blow over the pinnacle of, or the edge of, or the cavern of, and they would take large rakes, they would scoop it up, and they would throw it in the air. And chaff would be separated off, and the heavy seed would fall onto the threshing floor. These floors are about 25 by 40 feet in diameter. Lots of grain. They would get a nice pile, they'd sweep it up, scoop it into bins, and start the process over. It was a problem. That's when men like to steal from other men. So we have Boaz, a very large landowner, and the scripture says not only will he be at the floor watching his grain being winnowed, he's going to stay there all night. He's going to protect his own crop. Mounds of barley and wheat would be pushed up in the middle, waiting to go to a storage or a silo or to sell. Here Boaz will be tonight. When the sun starts down, I want you to know Boaz will be representative at the threshing floor protecting his own grain. Here's what we're going to do. Here's the commands. I want you to do this. Wash yourself, therefore. Anoint yourself and put on your best clothes. Now, guys, I'm just telling you, I don't know if this wins every man, but it would win me. If you're going to give me a choice with Wendy being dirty and grungy and nasty versus, hey, her hair all pretty and all dolled up and some sweet clothes on, oh, and a little foo-foo water is never a bad thing. I like it whenever I walk in and she is like presented that way in our company. He says, here's what I first want you to do this. I want you to take a shower. I want you to put a little oil on you that smells good. And oh, you know that pretty little gown that you have? Put that on. That'll get his eye. Where are we going? We're going to go to the threshing floor. When? Tonight. Who's going to be there? Boaz, our kinsman redeemer. And you're going to be presented, washed, anointed, and all dressed up. But there's a timing to this that's important. And I want you to see that it carries on in these commands. Behold, the winnow's barley, the threshing floor tonight. Wash yourself, anoint yourself, put on your best clothes. Go down to the threshing floor. Guys, this is a huge risk, by the way. Man, if a woman shows up at the threshing floor looking like that, wow. May not catch the eye of just Boaz, right? But oh, Boaz is already, hey, she's off limits. Don't you guys be touching her. And go down to the threshing floor, but do not make yourself known to the man, Boaz, until he has finished eating and drinking. But here's the deal. I don't want you just to plop into his life at sundown, all dressed to the nines. I want you to kind of be stealthy and wait till he has opportunity to have his gut filled with food and have plenty of wine in his belly. I want him to be totally satisfied and not distracted by you. I want this plan to go off without a hitch. So the scripture says, wait till he has finished eating and drinking. And it shall be, here's what I want you to do. And it shall be when he lies down, that ye shall notice the place where he lies, and ye shall go and uncover his feet and lie down. Then he will tell you what you shall do. And she said to her, all that you say, I will do. Middle Eastern tradition would look like this. There was a process by which you could find favor with someone, and a servant always, well, if a servant was in the midst of the proprietor or the owner, they could find themselves laying at his feet in humility and awaiting the next command to serve the boss. I want you to do this. I want you not to lay at his side. There's going to be zero promiscuity. This is not a filthy setting. This is a servant, humble setting. I want you at sundown, when he has had all he needs to eat and drink, be stealthy. When it gets to the place that you see him leave the area where he's having his meal, I want you to watch where he lays down. When he lays down, you wait till he is fully asleep, and you just lift up his outer garment or his provision of cover, and I want you to lay right at his feet and just pull it over you. Guys, you know what she's really saying? I want you to exact the right as a kinsman redeemer. I'm asking you to marry me. I want you to see in chapter 2, in verse 12, may the Lord reward your work. This is Boaz to Ruth. And your wages be full from the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to seek refuge. You see that little word, wings? You see that word, cover? Same word in the original text. A protector of one. Here's Boaz praying for Ruth. Man, you are an excellent woman. He's going to say that in just a minute. I see that not only your testimony that I hear in the city, you have found yourself to be an excellent woman. You're the real deal, Ruth. And here's what I'm going to pray for you. That God would give you protection and provision. But I'm going to tell you, the central focus is, I know where that's going to come from, and it's going to be like a eagle or a bird with its chicks. I want it to be like the folding over of protection as a mama bird does to her baby chicks. I want him to protect you. I want him to cover you. I want the wings of God to be your provision. The picture is the same. She's going to lay at the foot as a humble servant to Boaz. And the prayer request is going to be answered. She's going to take the wings of protection, and she's going to fold those over onto herself. And we're going to try to get a reaction. Boaz, will you accept me as your wife? A betrothal, an engagement, a setting aside of future hope. Well, we see that is the preparation. Now, I want you to see the presentation. This is where it really gets good. I told you about being in a kind of a roller coaster. We're fixing to get to the top pinnacle, and we're fixing to start down the other side, and we're going to really be going. It's going to be a beautiful scene in the life of Ruth. So she went down to the threshing floor and did according to all that her mother-in-law had commanded her. Every single cross T and dotted I. She's doing it all. She took a shower. She put some ointment on. She put her best dress on. She's stealthy. She's at the threshing floor. She's kind of has an eye on Boaz. Boaz, don't look over here. I'm going to wait for you. Boaz sits at the table. He's getting something to eat. He's having a little something to drink. And all of a sudden, we're fixing to get to the place where he's going to lie down and protect his grain. Ruth is like going to pounce on this. This is what we're going to do. When Boaz had eaten and drunk and his heart was merry, that doesn't mean he was drunk. It means he was satisfied. A drunk man can't watch his crop. You're not very much of a protector if you don't know where you're at. He knows where he's at. He's merry. He's full. He's satisfied. I'm going to go to bed. I'm going to catch a little shut-eye. It's going to be a long night. He went to lie down at the end of the heap of grain. It's already stacked up nice. We've worked all evening. And his feet, he covered his feet. Let's see, he went to the end of the heap, and she came secretly and uncovered his feet and lay down. The scene now changes to just a practice of hope. Now the reality is beginning to play out. Ruth is doing exactly what she was told to do by her mother-in-law. She sees him lay down. He's sound asleep. She slips at the bottom of his feet, pulls his outer garment over her, and now she's covered up. Protection as a wing. A mama to her babies. And this is the reaction. And it happened in the middle of the night. So about 12 o'clock, we got an issue. Well, what happens at 12 o'clock? What happens in the middle of the night? The man was startled and bent forward, and behold, a woman was lying at his feet. This was not customary at that day. We're sound asleep. I'm satisfied. I'm now at the place of protection for my barley. Ruth has done exactly what Naomi asked her to do. He is now asleep. She's at his feet. She's covered up. And all of a sudden, he realizes something's not right about this scene. Somebody's at my feet. And he's startled. Literally in fear. The word is to fear. He is shocked. He's scared. He sets up suddenly and he sees somebody at his feet. Well, we have an explanation to make because we're going to have an inquiry. It says, behold, she was lying at his feet, and he said, Boaz said to Ruth, who are you? And she answered, I am Ruth, your maid. I'm your servant. Remember me, I've been working and gleaning in the field. You gave me provision and you even gave me protection and you warned everybody. Yeah, I know who you are. So spread your covering over your maid, for you are a close relative. Will you accept me in the kinsman redeemer tradition according to the law? Will you marry me? Will you take me? Will you be my safe place? Will you be my rest? Will you be my security? Well, Boaz is sitting there in the middle of the night probably trying to figure out, I went to bed and no one was at my feet, and I'm waking up and I've got this lady draped at my feet, and she even covered herself with my outer garment, and she's now asking me to marry her, to be the kinsman redeemer. Guys, the scripture doesn't say. It was one of those moments where we went, yes. Or one of those moments going, gosh, let me gather my thoughts. All we know is the request has been made. Now look at this. Then he said, may you be blessed of the Lord, my daughter. He really gives her a beatitude. Barak gives her a blessing. He says, my daughter, you have shown your last kindness to be better than the first by not going after young men, whether poor or rich. Guys, Boaz is from Elimelech's generation, not from Ruth's generation. We're going to see in just a moment that really Boaz doesn't want to give any false hope to Ruth whatsoever. There's some younger guys that can meet that same requirement as a kinsman redeemer, Elimelech's family. More than cousins or whatever, there's some nephews that could do the same thing. And here she is, and he's startled, and he sets up, and in fear he says, well, who's at my feet? And he says, it's your maid. Remember me, it's Ruth. Will you be the kinsman redeemer? Will you bring security? Will you bring safety? Will you be my provision? And he looks at her and he says, Barak, I want to bless you with something. There's something about your character that I want to point out. You could have gone and taken an easy way out. You could have gone got a rich guy, or maybe not, but he could have been a whole lot younger than me. I'm just telling you, the fact that you chose me, I'm going to hear you out. Not only can I do this, and not only is it right for me to do this, I want to hear this out. You're asking me to betroth myself to you. You're asking me to be engaged to you for a future hope of marriage. Yes, that's what I'm asking of you, Boaz. Will you marry me? Now, I don't think it happened that way. I don't know about Colton and Bree, but it didn't happen like that with Wendy and I promise you. I asked her, and she said yes. Thank the Lord. Little did she know she was not getting the better end of the deal. But guys, we see that Naomi has really given her Ruth's well verse for doing this. She understands the provision of Scripture, and she understands that an identification of Boaz as the next of kin, this was the right thing to do, although it could have turned really ugly at this point. What if Boaz looks at Ruth and says, "No, away with you. I've been generous enough to you. I've given you all that I'm going to give you. I've provided protection, and I really don't want to enter into this engagement with you. I don't want to marry you." But he blesses her, and he shows her her character again, that she's waited until God has brought this provision as a kinsman redeemer. But it gets better. And the Scripture says, "And now it is true. I am a close relative." He looks at Ruth in the darkness in the midnight hour and he says, "You know what? You're not asking of me anything that's not scripturally right. I can marry you. But I don't want to bring you any false hope, Ruth." Man, you talk about a guy that's above board. That great wealth, this guy is phenomenal in his character. He could have tried to transaction this thing, and he could have tried to snooker this, and he could have tried to warp the scenario. He could have told Ruth whatever she wanted to hear, and she would have gone back to Naomi, "Yeah, it's a done deal." I want you to see how Boaz responds to Ruth. He says, "Here it is. It is true I'm a close relative. However, there is a relative closer than I." Now, Ruth, listen to me. I know what you're asking of me, and you're right to ask that. And as much as I just want to say yes right now, and as much as I just want to close the deal, and as much as I just want to seal this with a marriage, I don't want to give you any false hope or expectation that's not real. Did you know there's a guy in town that's also kin to Elimelech? And he gets first dibs. Because he's closer than me. I'm a generation removed. There's one that has the right to take you. He gets first shot. Oh, man. Guys, has God ever asked you to wait? Come on. Have you prayed for something and you know that it's right? You're not praying anything that's outside of his will. It's not like, you know, you examine your prayer at times. You think, well, because God has set silent on this or there's a delay in the answer, maybe I'm not praying correctly. Maybe my motive is wrong. Maybe my heart's not fixed right on Christ. Maybe it's me that needs to change. And you look at it and you dissect it and you examine your prayer and you think, well, it's biblical. It's not that I'm violating God's character or calling him into question to ask anything on my behalf that is outside of his will. He's just not acting right now. I'm waiting on him. Guys, you know how patient I am as an individual. Those who know me, my family is already chuckling. Patience is a virtue that I have seemed to lose at times. And I can't for the life of me find it. I know it's in there. Waiting is hard for a believer. Ruth, I know what you're asking of me. And guys, he's flattered. He's shocked. The fact that you would marry in a generation like this, I'm just an old man. The fact that you would even seek provision, that you would seek the guiding structure of the wings of God in this provision through the kinsman redeemer, it's just absolutely shocking to me. But I just want to tell you, as much as I want to pull the trigger on this thing, I can't. There's somebody else that's closer. Oh, you know Ruth's heart probably went, oh my. And now it is true, I'm a close relative. However, there's a relative closer than I. Remain this night, and when morning comes, if he will redeem you, good, let him redeem you. Oh my. I wonder what Ruth's prayer life. You think she just snuggled up at the foot of Boaz and just covered herself back up under his provision and went, okay, I'm just going to go night-night. She probably tossed. She probably turned. She was probably a wreck all night long. I know the one you're talking about. He is a closer relative. I do realize he gets first shot at this. I want you just to go back down to my feet, and I want you to lie down, and I want you to be covered with my protection as a wing provider, and I want you to wait because I need to settle this issue with the next of kin that's closer. Oh, my. You talk about a long, sleepless remainder of the night. And this is what happens. If he says, I will come to him. If he says yes. Now I want you to see how Boaz frames it. It's good. Ruth, I don't want you to think that this is a bad thing if he says yes. This is God's protection for you. This is his provision. I'll step aside. Oh, let him redeem you. But then he says this, but anytime you see but in the word, it's always a contrast. Hold your hat. It's either really, really good or really, really bad. This is really, really good. But after I go to the closest of kin, but if he does not wish to redeem you, and this is what Ruth wanted to hear, I will redeem you. And then he puts this little caveat on the end. As the Lord lives, now lie down until morning. Yeah, right. She does, but she didn't go to sleep. You know what he does? He makes an oath. He swears by God. You don't do this unless you want to lose your life if you break that covenant. He says, I'm going to go to that next of kin, the one that's a closer relative, and I'm going to work this thing out. And if he says, no, I won't take her. I will not practice the levirate tradition, or I will not become her kinsman redeemer. I'm telling you under the authority of the word of God, but as God is my witness, I'll marry you. Oh man, you want to know probably what the prayer was that night? Okay, now God, now hear me out. When Boaz goes and asks the closest relative, would you just have him say, nah, I don't want her. You never. I just want Boaz to be the kinsman redeemer. And I want all the people to know what a great God you are and provider because you sent Boaz my way. I'm sure she prayed and prayed and prayed all night. Lie down until morning. Let's close it out this morning with the proclamation. And so she lay at his feet until morning, and rose before one could recognize another. And he said, for all that could hear, listen to this. Man, this Boaz, he's something else. Not only does he want to be her provider, but he wants her reputation to be complete in Christ as pure. You know what would be said on the threshing floor if all of a sudden we see from underneath the covers, here's Ruth. She's just freshly washed the night before, and she's got a little ointment on, she's smelling good, and she's in her best dress, and they see her coming out of Boaz's sleeping area. Oh, we thought she was a woman of excellent character. And Boaz, we're not too sure about you anymore either. We don't want that to happen. We're at the feet, not at the side. No funny business. There's nothing like that went on. But Boaz wants to make double sure that this is not in the hearts and the minds of people. And so he makes this proclamation for anybody that's around there wants to hear. So Naomi, or so Ruth rises, and it's not even sunup yet. No one can recognize each other. And here's the command. Let it not be known that the woman came to the threshing floor. What you saw was above board. This is a pure request. Do not shape this in some vulgarity. Ruth is a special woman. Her reputation is absolutely honorable. She is a righteous lady. Don't any of you take this and twist it into something more than this was God's provision in the Redeemer way, the Levirate tradition. And then this happens. A woman came to the threshing floor. Let it be known that she came. Again, let it not be known that she came. And again he said, give me the cloak that is on your and hold it. So she held it, and the measure, and he measured out 6 measures of barley and laid it on her. Now listen, the New King James says 6 ephahs. That's 200 pounds of barley. It wasn't 6 ephahs. He just took 6 measures, and it's believed that that's about 60 pounds of barley or wheat. And so he looks at Ruth, and he says, look, you got to get out of here before the sun comes up. But before you go, I can't send you away without some... really some provision. You got to take something back as a gift to Naomi. And it wasn't like this little care package that he brought out, like this little fancy coffees or whatever, and he just says, hey, take that back. That'd be like a day's worth of bread. He says, give me your shawl. And either their head covering or was around their neck or around their waist, it was just this utility shawl. It was a large piece of material, and it was used for a variety of things. And he says, just give me your shawl. Just give it to me. And so she hands him the shawl, and Boaz lays it down, and he just takes a scoop, and he just fills it full of 6 measures of barley, wraps it up, puts it over her shoulder, and goes, take that to mama. It's been a good night in our future family, we pray. Now listen, when we get back to the house, we're going to have the same kind of reaction. Remember when Ruth got back home about 3 months ago with the first day's gathering? And Naomi goes, hey, Ruth, where did you glean today? That's a half a month's worth of barley. Where in the world did you get that? Well, now we're going to really bring home the goods. And the scripture says that when she came to her mother, or she went back into the city, and when she came to her mother-in-law, she said, how did it go, my daughter? Guys, not only did Ruth not sleep all night, but I promise you, the midnight oil was burning in Naomi's house too. She's on bent knee. She's up. She's probably just fretted. Oh, God, please, I pray this doesn't go off like a disaster. I pray that whenever Boaz recognizes it and that Ruth is at her feet, that he doesn't run her off. And when she asks for his hand in marriage, that he would be willing to at least entertain it. And immediately, the first thing she says when she cracks the door, hey, how did it go? What went on? Tell me about your evening. Oh, and by the way, you look great. You dress up nice, and you smell so good. Did you do everything I said? Yeah. Well, tell me how it went. And the scripture says, and again he said, give me the cloak. And so she did. And then Naomi, and when she arrives, how did it go, my daughter? And she told her all that the man had done for her. And you know, they probably talked all morning long. I know what it's like to be married to a wife. My day is this. Oh, it's fine. Guys, I made it home safe. I could have got hit by a bus. I got home. It's good. I'm just glad to be home. I know every single student that Wendy asks, and I've never met a one. I know their exceptionality. I will not break any law, so don't go turn us in. I know their names. I know what grade level they're on. I know how they were helped. Guys, I get to hear the whole thing, and it's so exciting. Is when Wendy gets to play it back, it's just like we're watching a movie played out in her mind, and she's just speaking the dialogue with me. She's filling in all the blanks. Can you imagine this conversation the next morning? Mama, listen to what happened to me last night. You know I did exactly what you said? Yeah. You know about midnight? He said straight up in bed, he was scared to death. And he says, who is it? And I told him it was me. And I just asked him to marry me. You know what he told me? man, I would love to say yes, but I can't. There's another guy in line. And he told me all about him. Well, what did he say about if the guy said no? He said he would marry me. He said he would take me as his wife. And the scripture says, and she, again, give me the cloak. And he did. And how did it go? And she told her. And she said, these 6 measures of barley he gave to me, for he said, do not go to your mother-in-law empty-handed. Don't you dare go home without a gift. I'm going to load you up. And look what he gave us. And plopping that on the dining room table, 60 pounds of, cracked corn right there. But listen to verse 18. This is a cliffhanger for next week. And then she said, man, this had to be hard. You know what? Wait, my daughter, until you know how the matter turns out. Don't say anything. Don't do anything. Don't go try to manipulate it. Don't keep calling him on the phone. Quit texting him. You set silent. You wait. Because this is what I know about Boaz. Now listen to the end. I want you to wait till the matter turns out. For the man will not rest until he has settled it today. And I want you to see how the next scene opens. Now Boaz went up to the gate and sat down, and behold, a close relative of whom Boaz spoke came by. Man, you know what? He probably looked at that big old pile of grain and he went, hey, you guys watch this. I'm going to town. I'm finding that guy. And he went to the city gate where all transactions were made. And he plopped himself down and he sees that guy coming from a distance. And we're going to have a meeting. We're going to settle the issue of kinsman redeemer, the wings of protection for Ruth. Now, that's chapter 3. Well, what am I supposed to glean from this? What am I supposed to take from this? That at God's highest watermark for you, He wants to protect you. He wants to provide for you. He wants to be the wing by which you are covered. But what does He want us to do in our life while He's doing this? Wait on Him. Guys, I don't know what you're going through in your life, but I know this. He's worth waiting on. If the timing is not right, do not jump the gun. Don't begin to manipulate pieces on the puzzle. They don't fit. You would have to change the whole construction of the tapestry to get that piece to fit. You wait on God. And when God says it's time to put that piece into place, He'll put it into place, and it will look beautiful in the overall scene of what's being done in your life. Don't waste your time worrying or trying to change your life. You wait on Him. And when you wait on Him, wait this way. You see how Naomi shaped this to Ruth? She could have said, go to your room and just wait. But she said this, I know what Boaz is going to do today. He won't rest till it's over. Can I tell you something? God's at work in your life right now, doing for you right now what you cannot do for yourself. Not only do you wait, but you wait with anticipation of God's goodness to you. Guys, you know either way, Naomi's prayer was answered for Ruth. Did you know either way that Boaz's prayer for Ruth was answered? Either way, she wins. You know why you can wait on God? I read the end of the book. We win. Guys, one of these days we're going to stand at glory, face to face with the Creator King, the one who called us by name, sealed us in truth,
executed through the resurrection of his son. And I can tell you this, we will not be disappointed. Say, Rob, could this story be different? Yeah. That next of kin could really be Ruth's husband. But she would not be disappointed because it was still a gift from God. We know the rest of the story. We know how this story ends. But either way, Ruth is taken care of by a loving, holy God. You ever fear for your life? In that you fret and worry about your future? Rest in God. Wait. And when he speaks, heaven cannot hold, earth cannot explain, and you cannot keep from worshiping the one true God. Father, thank you for this time and for your word. And as we get into chapter 4 next week, wow, we see the culmination of this story, and the roller coaster is fixing to be at max speed. Folks, we're going to, together as a church, collectively, we're going to see how this all plays out and all this groundwork that's taken place and all this understanding of kinsman redeemer and brother-in-law and a close relative and, oh my, it's all going to come to a head. And Father, we're going to see the magnificent glory of your protective hand on Ruth and Naomi. But Father, it's the story of Christ. How we too, desperate for you to show up on our behalf, as we even heard this morning in Bree's testimony. Such gripping desperation when we see ourselves for who we really are, separated from your love, from our own sin. But God, the provision of your Son and the finished work at Calvary, secured in the resurrection in an empty tomb, we have much to say grace over, much to rejoice in. So, Father, you are the ultimate kinsman redeemer, the ultimate closer than a relative, that you are the provider king. And, Father, we stand today waiting on you. And while we wait, we anticipate great things from your hand. For you're a good God. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand and sing our last song. Behold our God. Very appropriate.
In his hands, who has numbered every grain of sand? Kings and nations tremble at his voice. All creation rises to rejoice. Behold, our God seated on his throne. Come, let us adore him. Behold our King, nothing can compare. Come, let us adore him. Given counsel to the Lord, who can question any of his words? Who can teach the one who knows all things? Who can fathom all his wondrous deeds?
Behold our God seated on his throne. Come, let us adore him. Behold our King, nothing can compare. Come, let us adore him. Who has felt the nails upon his hands, bearing all the guilt of sinful man? God eternal, humble to the grave, Jesus Savior, risen now to reign. Behold our God seated on his throne. Come, let us adore him. Behold our King, nothing can compare. Come, let us adore him. You will reign forever. You will reign forever. You will reign forever. You will reign forever. Behold our God seated on his throne. Come, let us adore him. Behold our King, nothing can compare. Come, let us adore him. Behold our God seated on his throne. Come, let us adore him. Behold our King, nothing can compare. Come, let us adore him.
Maybe you're here this morning and you can't sing that. You don't know the verses of God's salvation. Today would be a great day. If you come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, that you've heard the gospel of the truth this morning. Now the secure and protective hand of God is found in his Son, Jesus Christ. He exacted a Calvary for the forgiveness of sin and secured the eternal life of the resurrection of Jesus Christ to be made. If God is dealing with you this morning, he's calling you to himself. Don't harden your heart. You come. God will save you just like that startled Boaz set up in bed. Who is it? Oh, I'll be your kids. I'll save you. You cry out, you will not be disappointed in what God does in your life. But maybe you're here and you're a born-again believer. And you're like me, and sometimes I have a hard time waiting on God's timing. Rest in God. He is secure. He is faithful to carry out what he starts. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time together, and for the provision of your grace and the understanding of your goodness that we see in this simple story. Father, it just points to and is absolutely saturated in the gospel and the person and work of Christ. This is our story. Destitute, broken, and bankrupt. No hope. And you show up. And you don't send us away with bargain. You send send us away with the gift of salvation in Jesus Christ. Father, let us find ourselves worshiping you, for you are worthy of all praise and adoration. We love you and thank you. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Before you get away,